market's like a person, one of a kind. That's what makes it special. The market is different because everyone in it is different.
So it's got its own little world and its own little ambience going on. Okay, that's a little bit different from the rest of Tooting.
When I was a child, I wanted to be one of two things. I wanted to be a fireman, but I was a little bit too short. Or I wanted to be a marine biologist, but I wasn't really intelligent enough, I'm afraid. I was born in Stoneleigh and my parents split up and I had to live with my nan in Tooting. So that's how I ended up in Tooting. And I worked in a pet shop on Saturdays in Collierswood. And from there, I came here and the rest, I'm still here 37 years later.
When I was a child, I wanted to be a DJ. History of our shop. Came here in 1972, and we decided that we wanted to provide music, vinyl records, to our local public, which the type of music that we were specialising was very hard to actually acquire in England. So we set up a shop, had a lot of connections in Jamaica, imported a lot of stuff from Jamaica into the UK, and basically started trading right here in Tooting Market in 1972. And up until this day, we are still here.
Well, I came from Kenya in 1968, February. And I looked for a job because I didn't want to go on the dole. I just looked for a job. And I found one job in city, Clerkenwell, W. Friedman and Sons. From Kenya, my father was self-employed. And I wanted to be a self-employed, and I looked for a place where I can open my own place. And I started in 1970 as a watch repairs, sales and repairs.
This has been a pet shop for probably about 50 years. About 25 years ago, the market did have a fire. So this is new. The next door is new and here is new. So there was a fire in the corner about 25 years ago.
My mum gave birth to my sister on the fruit and veg place around there. She's always been a worker. You know, pregnancy is not an illness, it's a gift. So she would always work. And yeah, she went into labour around there on the fruit and veg place. And I used to come through it as a child on my skateboard. Started chatting to a few people. They get to see me, little troublemaker as a youngster. And he remembers me as a youngster, didn't you, Graham? Yeah, skateboard and that. Yeah. All right, you had your go. But, yeah. So, yeah, and I started talking to Tom and a few other people, Margaret and Fred over there, give me a job, opening and shutting the shop in the daytime. Then when I got to a certain age, Tom took me on here. When I was 14, I think, working Saturday. Then when I got to 16, he took me on full-time, but moved me to Balham with his uncle. Tommy White, he was 16 when he came over here. He started working in Balham Market for his uncle, Tommy Mac. Come from Tipperary, Ireland, Tipperary. And from there, he come over here and started running this shop for 50 years, and he's been here ever since. He was a good guy, kind, generous, good guy to work for, do anything for you. He's just a nice guy.
I started off in this market many, many years ago because my mum had a shop around the corner selling belts, wallets, purses, special tablecloth, that sort of thing. I've known Gary, the current owner, for quite a long time now, since I was about, I don't know, 13, 14. And he just asked me one day, he said, do you fancy learning the trade? At the time I didn't have a job, so I said to him, yeah, why not? And the rest is history. This shop is an original shop. It's been here since the market opened in 1936. The current owner has had it for over 25 years. It was his dad's before him, and his dad's before that. It's, as I said, it's basically, as far as I'm aware, been passed since the shop opened, been passed down through the family.
My dad's brother taught me, actually. So there is, you know, there is a few members in the family. Many years ago and that, when my dad was doing it for, since my granddad actually, my dad was doing it for 20 years and my granddad was in it for, I think, all of his life actually.
My dad had a butcher shop. He started that in 1966. I was born in 1968 and we've been here since, really. I think I started pushing a broom on a Saturday morning, about your age. Yeah, so yeah. And then I used to come in the summer holidays when I was 12, 13. Well, my dad became a farmer. He decided that he had enough of the butchers and he became a farmer, beef cattle and sheep, and me and my brothers took the family butchers over.
We've had some funny ones over the years, but I think the funniest one was a young lady, two pairs of shoes come in, and they were pretty much exactly the same shoe, same size, same everything. And we repaired the shoes as quick as possible, and they got bagged up. Two rights got bagged up in one bag, and two lefts got bagged up in the other bag. And we didn't spot this. The first customer come in to pick her shoes up, she come back within an hour and she's noticed it straight away. And we apologised to her and said, could you wait a couple of days? And she was really nice and everything. But this other customer never, ever, ever come back for the shoes. So we ended up buying this customer a new pair of shoes. It wasn't a great deal of money. I think it was about £30, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And I would say about a year later, this very old lady come in and she said about, we've done a pair of shoes for her and we've done an absolutely terrible job on her shoes. And I said to her, well, can I see the shoes then? She said, yeah, and she had them on at the time. She had two left shoes on.
There's two markets. There's Tooting Market and there's Broadway Market. They were built at the same time. This has always been the Broadway Market. It is the larger of the two markets.
In the 1950s, it was just after the war, and things were pretty tight. So therefore, one dealer might have something that the other one didn't have. So therefore, you went to him. But then the next week, the other dealers would have something that you wanted.
It wasn't like it is now. It was all more stalls rather than the, like, little individual units as such like this. It was actually like proper market stalls just undercover, really. And then it's just evolved little by little ever since.
Clothes, fruit, meat, articles of second-hand goods. There was screw shops, there was tool shops. Whatever you wanted to buy, you come to the market to buy it because you couldn't afford to buy it outside. It was cheaper.
The rents were cheap in the old days, to start with. It gave you, if you didn't have a lot of money behind you, it gave you a chance. And if you you made a go of it, then you stayed and kept paying your way. And if you didn't, you walked away without being tied into a lease.
Not a lot really has changed from them since they've been open. They're still fairly original in their construction. Obviously they get, you know, stuff like this. The floors were first painted about 1995, supposedly because it's non-slip and it looked different. But that's only cosmetic. The actual nature of the markets is very little has changed in itself since they were built. They're still fairly original.
It used to be so busy. I would just remember queues and queues of people, everyone. It was such a bustling market, it was unreal.
Unless you needed something, you didn't actually come in here at Christmas time. It was far too busy. It was a nightmare. Imagine the busiest shop you've ever seen when it's at Christmas time and then times that by 10, and that was what it was like. You had to fight to get anywhere. If you had a buggy with kids in it, you certainly didn't come near the place because you would never have got through.
You used to have a good atmosphere near Christmas,
very good,
though.
Very good,
because everybody
yes.
comes.
And you knew it was Christmas.
It was only Tooting, really, that most people...
A lot of people came.
Yeah, came all over from around the surroundings. It's just selling lots of extra food.
It was exciting.
You've got extra things, extra turkeys and hams and hanging up. And you...
A lot more.
Decorations and and everything. The only thing, it used to be always cold in this market, just for a, used to be cold.
It was a thriving market. Tooting Broadway Market was a thriving market in the 70s, right up until the late 80s. At this particular time, we have no competitors around us. Years ago, you had quite a few. Wandsworth, Croydon, you had a couple in Tooting. Brixton, all the local eras, there was many, say, 2 to 3 different record shops.
My favourite memory of the market when I came here, I was a little boy, I was like 10 years old, and they had like lots of fairs and fun fairs and stuff in the market at that time for kids. You know, when a new shop is opening, they hold big fairs and stuff to promote their goods and all that.
My earliest memory, because I was actually brought up in Tooting, because I came to Tooting in 1969, and my earliest memory is running through this market with a lot of my friends. We used to play in this market.
There was quite a lot of life in the market. You could hear music. At the time there was a shop that used to blare a lot of like old reggae tunes, and it kind of made the market feel quite upbeat. It was a nice vibe.
Because I was born in Jamaica, market is a big thing for us back home, especially on a Saturday. It's like a rich, you go out shopping for food such as yam, banana, all the Caribbean stuff. And the best place to find that would normally be in the market.
It used to be closed half day on a Wednesday.
That's right.
Yes, yes. Couldn't come, yes, couldn't, that's right.
After closing.
Yeah. And there was a stall there, fruit and veg stall, at the beginning there, that was the only fruit and veg stall, and they used to sell it very fruit and veg very cheap. But when you get home, you're not happy with what you get. Mm. Because they used to sell the stuff from the top.
Yes, that's
yeah,
right.
You used to see lovely stuff that's in the at the top of the pile. But when they serve you, they take it from the bottom,
yes,
don't they?
That's right.
And then when you get home, it's all inferior stuff.
As I say, it's when they were first built, it was always busy in here. And then about 1990, things changed. Said the lady that owned this market died and things happened. But unfortunately, that was also the time where you started getting very large supermarkets, like the Saver Centre was built about that time. And it did affect business in this market and the next market. And like, to be honest, small local shops in general.
In the 90s, there were no stores in this actual market. We were like the only stall in this market. Very quiet it was at the time. Almost like a ghost town. And over the years, it's built back up.
Down here, big one. You had the sports shop, you had the popcorn and donut shop, obviously this one, Live Hills over there, Graham's always been there, Tracy's been there, ain't done much but she's been there. We used to have a bloke there selling jewellery, Cheap Jack.
got my first present from my first girlfriend from there. £2.50, I think. What else is here? Actually, I worked in another shop there, still helium, selling balloons. So I used to talk to the customers, and they loved it, though. They loved it, man.
Memorable people. There used to be a lady opposite here called Vera. She used to sell buckets and household goods. She used to make us tea, and we had a really good relationship. She's passed away now, I'm afraid, and we all miss Vera. That was her name. We all miss her loads.
Yeah, we had a watch shop round the corner here, which was very popular. They fix a lot of people's watches. That time, people using watches a lot. which they're still over in the market here, just over the road there. He even had a record shop who was there before us. He left about a year after we actually came here in 1972.
One of the memorable, there's a lot of them, but one key one that is still striking in my mind is the fish shop over there. Probably you might notice from when you were coming inside this way. They've been around probably from before I was born, because it's been there for 50 years. And then I remember when I was growing up, we'd come in with my mom and we'd do some shopping, we'd buy fish there. So it's amazing to see how it's gone from one generation of the same family down to another.
The fish stall around the corner. Yes. We've been with him over 40 years. Yes. Unfortunately, he passed away.
He died, yes. We was laughing and joking about the football, me and him and the customer. Laughing and joking. I could see, you still see a smile on his face. I looked away for me a second, looked back, and he's on the floor clenching his heart. It was just one of those things. Had a weak heart and major heart attack, and he didn't come through. You can just see how much of a nice guy he was just by the funeral. And that was not even half of our customers that went to the funeral.
Yeah, there used to be an eel shop in the market that actually sold live eels that used to buy live, and they used to chop them up, and they still wiggled. That used to be just next door here. This used to be Marshall's, a closed shop next door here. So lots of things have changed. A lot of the shops have fronts on now, so people used to stand outside the shops and we all used to chat, whereas it doesn't happen so much anymore. I'm a cat lover. I love my cat, and we used to sell cats here, and I used to get quite attached to cats and be really fussy about who bought them. If someone said, I want that cat, and I didn't like them very much, I would say, no, it's already sold. So yeah, cats are my weakness, and parrots as well.
We do get a lot of posh stuff in here. The dearest pair of shoes we've ever had in here was, I think I'd done a pair of, what were they called?
They're a pair of boots.
Schroff, is it?
Yeah, Coveney Schroffsky crystals.
Schroff, that's £6,500.
While at my skills good, said Gary asked me one day, would I like to, come work with him, learn the trade. And basically it was like an apprenticeship, just learn over time, as time goes on.
Father was a watchmaker too, and I've learned from him quite a lot. He's like a teacher to me. We are four brothers and we are all watchmakers. So there you are. And one of my son has also inherited the same skill and same job. Like back in Kenya, there used to be a winding watches. And then as time passes, a lot of watches are turning into quartz watches and all these electronic watches. I do get, there's like a challenge. Sometimes there are, been so many years in experience. Customer comes down and says, we have been to the so many places and no one can repair it. I say, there's nothing impossible.
I will not deliver some Kong wheel from Balham to Tooting. Yeah, he put two big 6-footers in a black sack. Start taking them on the underground. So I gets down on the train, puts the black sack down on the floor till I get the Tooting. I get to Tooting, pick the black sack up, throws it over my shoulder. Bag just goes everywhere. Fish everywhere. A couple of people screamed because they didn't know what the bloody hell they were, slimy conger eels. So I had to throw them over my shoulder, walk them like a scarf, all the way here, up the excavator, everyone looking at me, giving me dirty looks, laughing and joking. Didn't know where to put my face. I had to get here, give Tom the fish, I had to go home and have a bath because I looked a state, quite frankly. Full of white slime, everywhere it was. I couldn't explain it, everywhere. Worst day of my life.
My favourite story is, which I have told once before, We used to have a macaw, which is a very big South American parrot. It used to be in the shop, and it used to be loose out on a perch. And it used to have its wing clipped, so it couldn't fly that well, which didn't hurt it, and it used to grow back. But every maybe 3 months, we used to have it reclipped, and we hadn't had it clipped. And on a Saturday, it decided to take off, and it flew down this market all the way. On a Saturday, when the market was really busy, and everyone was ducking, it flew across the road, just missed the bus, an 88, and it went in a shop called Burton's. I don't think Burton's exist anymore, do they? No. So yeah, that was one memorable thing that happened in the market for me.
Normally in here, like, we're all friends in here, but when it's your birthday, you don't tell anyone in the market, because you either get wet or they try and throw you in the dustbin.
Yes, I have been here 47 years. I get a lot of customers, but the customer used to come with their young boys who were 4, 5 years, 8 years old. They are our parents now. Like, my children were born here, they are parents and they got children. So they come and they says, look, this is gentleman we know such a long time. I used to come with the granddad when I was 5.
So we got 3, 4, 5 generations coming in now. Ones that I knew when I was a boy, they're starting to get old. Some have passed away, and some are quite old now, you know, like in their 70s and 80s, so they're not buying quite so much meat as they did when I was younger.
We still have customers from in the 80s still coming back to us today. Yeah, we provide a good service. We go out of our way to actually provide and access things for people, and it's amazing. It's a little thing, but in a lot of people's life, it brings a lot of joy.
We used to have everything, the plaice, the cod, rock salmon, you name it, we used to have it. I went away, come back, and things have changed. I don't know whether the people that want the fillet and stuff and, you know, moved away, and other people come in and they, you know, we just got to get what the customers want. Obviously, we've got fish, all different fish from all around the world. Now we've got Jamaican snappers, we've got tilapia from Mozambique, red bream from Iceland. Obviously, people want fish that they're brought up with, you know?
I mean, as little as 20 years ago, maybe 30 years ago, all shoes were made of leather. There was no such thing as a plastic shoe. You couldn't just pop into a shop and buy a pair of shoes cheap for £5. Shoes cost reasonable money because they were made properly, made out of leather, and they were expensive.
Once an Irish guy come in and asked if we sharpened lawnmower blades. And I said, yeah, of course we're doing that. Just bring it in and everything. Oh, I heard this noise and I thought it was someone riding a motorbike in the market. And the guys come in the market with a lawnmower, one of the ride, you know, the ones you sit on to ride. I couldn't believe it. You know, how can you think of anything more dangerous?
All my customers are very happy. They're always very happy because they get big discounts. Yeah?
Yeah, we've got such good customers. Don't
yeah,
we?
Like, because our customer base is like 80% regulars, so it's like working with friends.
Yeah, basically.
Sometimes they pop up just to say hi, even if they're not going to buy anything, they're just, hi Sonia, how are you?
Years ago, I think it was, they catered more for the Caribbean people, but now obviously we have people from all walks of life here. So, you know, we've noticed sort of going to the fruit stalls, there's vegetables and fruits which I don't recognize, which obviously I want to find out about. Years ago, I knew all the fruit and vegetable because most of them came from England or Caribbean or Africa.
Ooh, I remember trying to get my nose pierced, this one here, when I was like 15, because there used to be a tattoo and piercing shop. I think it was just at the end. And I tried to come here, but I was underage and I didn't have ID, so they were like, no, you're not allowed.
My favourite shop in the market, I'm going to have to say, here, the nail bar, having my nails done.
And then that shop there,
yes,
it does very nice, fresh things.
Western,
yeah. Food. Yes, fresh things from all over the world.
Yes.
Yeah. And they're very nice people. Yeah.
I have customers, they don't speak the language, so I speak Spanish, Portuguese and English. Sometimes they even come for photography. They just come, Sonia, can you please fill in this out, please? I really need it.
I make them laugh. So I believe when they're coming here, some of them are very burdened. You know, London is a very stressful place. Some of them live alone. They don't have family. Some don't have friends. Some, you know, when they come out, that's the only time they get to see people. And, you know, so when they come here, I make that determination that I'll make sure they leave here smiling. So because of that, a lot of people love the shop. They love coming to my place, even when they're not buying anything, because it's good to take a bit of weight off somebody's shoulder.
Opening a shop in the market is a very good way of creating a small business with very minimal costs.
I was born and bred in South London, grew up in Tooting Beck. My shop originated from Camden Town, originally. Okay, I was in Camden Town for 5 years, okay, working with my oldest daughter, and I couldn't be bothered to keep going up to Camden. So this is why I end up in Tooting Broadway, having a go, trying to bring something new and different to the area, because I like it. I like leather jackets, okay. I've always liked wearing leather jackets. So, you know, what could be better than selling what you love? You might not become a millionaire, okay, right, but you'll always have contentedness.
Basically, I am an author and I'm self-employed. So for many, many years, I've been selling my book door to door. I came to the conclusion I need to raise my profile. So I thought, okay, I'd like a shop, but it would be better to start in a very basic, humble way like the market. I've sold a lot of books here, and while I'm here, I sell indoor and outdoor plants, art and craft stationery, household goods and bits and pieces like that, and it's going very well.
I was born in Italy, in a town called Bari, which is in the south of Italy. I used to be an actress, and then at some point I decided that I wanted to do something less ego-centered, but very good for the people, but similar in creativity. So I decided to do a course in pastry, become a pastry chef, and then to make cakes, good cakes, healthy cakes and organic cakes for everybody, and especially for my children.
I used to be a nanny and looked after children, and when my last job finished, I decided that I would like to do something for myself. And I like painting, I like making things, so I decided to open a little shop.
Well, so I'm the manager of this store, and my boss decided to open a third shop here because the market's kind of being regenerated and a lot of new businesses are appearing, which kind of complement what we do. So there's loads of restaurants, there's other drink places, and then there was nowhere selling beer, so I think that was the next logical step.
It's really nice, it's really homely, and like it's such a nice space to work because just everyone's so friendly, and it's so different than like working on a high street because there's a real sense of community, and I think that could be getting lost, but that's definitely why I came here.
It's under shelter. Not many markets are under shelter. So in the winter, we're lucky that, you know, we're not going to get rained on or snowed on.
Because what they do is they turn on the heating when it's like, when you're just about to get frostbite. So they only turn it on when you're like near frozen. So when you're like,
like
trying
right
to wash
now, I'm
spinach
just, yeah.
In like ice cold water, trying to juice spit, it's so stressful.
This market has changed a lot since I was a kid. It's a lot quieter now, okay, but it needs to have a change and a revamp, okay. My personal view is that, okay, it's still a little bit backdated, 20 years behind its time, okay, so I think it could do with an uplift, an influx of new businesses, okay, and some fresh new ideas to come into the place, like mine, for instance.
I could see the market going stronger with all the new ideas, new implementation that they're bringing in. Renovation, bringing in a lot of different diversified businesses. And like I said, the more of that they bring in, I believe the better for the market.
Actually, they're building next door to expand the market, to have more stalls and restaurants. And I think it will become the next Brixton market, which is nice. So very, very nice and funky. That's the right word, probably, and cool.
I was just going to say gentrification, but I mean, that's just a very cynical way of looking at things, so let's not indulge that.
But they want to lock this off, lock that side off, so they can have it open till about 12, 1 o'clock in the morning, around here, so they just want food and wine places and stuff like that. For the price of it, I mean,
I wouldn't pay £10 for just a burger or £3.20 for a little cupcake. You know, it's not the sort of people, the old people ain't going to pay that sort of money. So I think they're looking at the younger people and the upper class people.
We have got some other issues with Crossrail, and we're waiting for that to happen, but that's over 6-7 years time. But I think the future of the market is pretty bright.
No one else in my family has ever carried on the trade now. I've got three brothers, and you know, my youngest brother's a black cab driver, my other brother's a carpenter, and my other brother's a locksmith. And no one's carried on the shoe trade, apart from me. I'm the only one. But I've got three sons myself, and all of them are very interested in the trade. So I have no doubts whatsoever. You know, we'll be trying. We've already got my boy working for us every Saturday.
You know, we need to pass it on to the next generation. They need to start eating fish, but, you know, with fish, you've got to season it and all that. Like, it's been too much work. It's not like a burger. You just stick in the oven, take out a bit of bun, that's it. You know, you've got to season this fish, spend a bit of time with it, clean it, and all that.